Hey guys, Jake with 8020 Media here. Today we're talking about engine overheating, and more specifically the causes of overheating, as well as steps to diagnose and fix the underlying cause of why your engine is overheating. Engines are built to operate within specific operating temperatures. When you go over those operating temperatures and the engine starts overheating, it can cause significant damage to the engine's internal components, as well as some other very serious engine components like your head gaskets, your intake manifold, exhaust manifold, and so on. Ultimately, overheating can lead to a ton of reliability and engine longevity issues and leave you with very expensive repair bills. Now, there are tons of different things that can cause an engine to overheat, and so we're putting this video together to give you guys the most common reasons engines overheat, as well as diagnostic steps to help you troubleshoot why your engine's overheating and what specific part is causing the engine to overheat. So jumping into things, I have a list of the 10 most common things that cause overheating, and then we're gonna follow this off with a list of 10 different diagnostic steps that you can take to test all of these 10 different causes. I'm gonna list these causes not in the order of likelihood, but in the order that I would go through and check them from a diagnostic standpoint. And so generally speaking, we're starting off with the ones that are the easiest to diagnose or the easiest ones to check, and moving on to the ones that are more difficult. So first off, number one on our list is low coolant levels. Then we have low oil levels. The third thing is coolant leaks. Now, coolant leaks can come from coolant hoses, the radiator itself, the water pump, or the coolant tank, but we are going to loop all of that into a general coolant leak category. Fourth on the list is the radiator cap, then moving on to cooling fan issues, and then to a faulty coolant temp sensor. Number seven on the list is water pump failure. Number eight, closely associated with the water pump, is the thermostat. Number nine is a bad radiator, and we're speaking about the radiator itself. And then number 10 is head gasket failure. Like I mentioned, this is a lot of problems. Let's go ahead and jump into the steps that you can take to test all of these things in the order that we recommend testing them. So you can use this as a checklist and just go down each one of these things to test them. And hopefully somewhere higher up on the list, you run into what the cause is and are able to fix it easily. So the first thing is to check your coolant levels and make sure you have enough coolant within your cooling system. That will make sure that low coolant levels aren't what's causing the overheating. Second thing is to check your oil levels. When you get low on oil, that causes excess friction from the metal components with your engine, and metal on metal friction causes increased heat, which can lead to engine overheating. So check and make sure that you've got enough oil in your engine. If it's not coolant levels or oil levels, then next we're gonna want to check for leaks within the cooling system. The easiest way to do this is to use a pressurized leak detector. What you're gonna do is unscrew your radiator cap, hook it up to your radiator, and then you're going to essentially pressurize the cooling system by pumping air into it. By pressurizing the system, that will cause any leaks to expose themselves. And so then you should be able to visually see any leaks coming from hoses, from the radiator itself, the tank, the water pump, and so on, visually through the engine bay, or you should be able to see coolant coming down onto your garage floor, which you can then trace back up to the location that it's coming from. After you've checked for leaks, if there are no leaks in the system, then we recommend inspecting your radiator cap. Because we're taking the radiator cap off while we're doing the leak test, there still is a possibility that pressure is leaking out from the radiator cap. So I recommend just visually inspecting it. If your radiator cap looks old, worn down, or maybe scuffed up a bit, then I'd just replace it. Radiator caps are very inexpensive, so I recommend just biting the bullet, buying a new one, and seeing if that fixes it. If it's not the radiator cap, then the next thing that we're gonna turn to is the cooling fan. The cooling fan is also commonly referred to as a radiator fan. It looks like a normal blade fan, and it spins and just blows air through the radiator. Since the radiator essentially has air passages in it called fins, And when the cooling fan blows air through it, it helps cool down the coolant that's passing through the radiator. If the cooling fan isn't working, it's not blowing the air through the radiator, and therefore the radiator is not going to be able to effectively cool all of the coolant. When it comes to checking the cooling fan, there are a couple different things that can cause the cooling fan to not work. The first thing that we're going to want to test is whether the cooling fan spins or not. To test whether it spins, you're going to want to turn your engine on and turn your air conditioning on full blast. With your air conditioning on full blast, the radiator fan should kick on and you should be able to visually look and see that it is actually spinning. If you can't see your radiator fan, you can also listen for it. You should be able to hear the noise of the radiator fan kicking on. It'll make a whirring or kind of fan-like noise, and so you should be able to listen for it as well. If the fan isn't spinning, there are a couple things that can cause this. The best place to start is by checking your fuses and your relays, as there should be one of each of these for your cooling system and for the fan specifically. If you have a good fuse and a good relay, then the issue could be with the fan's motor itself. Some fans are mechanically driven by the accessory belt. A lot of fans in newer cars are electronically driven, which means that they have an electric motor on them, and that electric motor is what spins it. If you have a belt-driven fan, then the motor's not going to be a problem because you don't have a motor. But if you do have an electric fan, then the motor is a frequent issue. You can hook jumper cables up to them, and you'll want to look up a specific DIY guide for doing this because you'll need to find the specific wires to hook it up to. But you can hook wires up to it from a jumper cable and essentially be able to manually cause the fan to spin by providing the electrical current that it needs. That will let you know whether the motor is good or bad. If the fan spins with the electrical current, it means the motor's good, and if it doesn't, then it means the motor's bad. Now, if you've tried all that and the motor still isn't spinning, then it could be the sixth cause on our list, which is a faulty coolant temperature sensor. The coolant temperature sensor essentially relays to the engine what the temperature of the coolant is, and the fan and the fan's control module uses that information to know when the fan should kick on. If the sensor is faulty, it can send bad readings to the fan, and the fan can think that it never needs to turn on, and therefore it never does. Coolant temp sensors are a little bit more challenging to actually test, but they are relatively inexpensive, and so if you've made it all the way this far down the list, I recommend just getting a new sensor and popping that in and seeing if that fixes the issues with your fan. Next, if you don't have any issues with your cooling fan, then the next thing that we're going to look to is the water pump. The water pump is probably one of the more common causes of an engine overheating. However, we have it a little bit lower down on the list since it can be a little bit more challenging to diagnose. Fortunately, water pumps have a small hole in them called the weep hole. And whenever one of the internal seals or internal components of the water pump starts to fail, you'll notice that there's coolant dripping out of that weep hole. So we recommend that you visually inspect the water pump, figure out where it's located in your engine, look for the weep hole on it, and watch to see if coolant is dripping out of the weep hole. Diagnosing whether or not it is the water pump is a little bit easier, but this is lower on the list because it is a little bit more expensive and challenging of a replacement, especially if you do not have mechanical skills, just since the water pump typically isn't located in the most convenient spot within the engine bay. If the water pump visually looks okay, there are no leaks coming out of it, then the next thing that it could be is the thermostat. The thermostat works in conjunction with the water pump by essentially opening and closing and controlling flow of coolant through the engine. When an engine first turns on, the thermostat is going to be completely closed to allow the engine to warm up to operating temperature. Once the engine gets warm enough, then the thermostat opens up and starts flowing coolant throughout the whole engine. The thermostat can fail stuck or fail open, which can either cause no coolant to flow or can cause coolant to flow 100% of the time. The easiest way to diagnose issues with the thermostat is to grab a hold of the upper radiator hose, turn your car on, and feel for coolant flowing through it. If your engine's cold and you just turn it on and you feel coolant flowing through immediately, that means that your thermostat is stuck open. Alternatively, if you keep your hand on that radiator hose for a couple minutes, allow the engine to heat up. Then once the engine gets up to operating temperature, the thermostat should open up and start to flow coolant. And so if your engine warms up and you still don't feel any coolant flowing through that hose, that means then you likely have an issue with your thermostat being stuck closed. Moving on to the ninth thing on the list, the radiator itself. Radiators are metal components, and the inside of a radiator can corrode and cause it to essentially get clogged up. So it is possible for the radiator itself to fail and just not be able to flow enough coolant to adequately cool the engine. If none of these other things on the list are your problem, then I recommend replacing the radiator, which unfortunately is going to be a little bit more expensive of a part to replace. If it isn't the radiator and you've inspected every other part of the cooling system, then the last thing that it could potentially be is head gasket failure. Head gasket failure is a common cause of overheating, but overheating is also a common thing that can lead to head gasket failure. Diagnosing head gasket failure is a little bit more challenging. You'll need to get your engine compression tested, which more than likely you'll need to have done at a professional repair shop. And so I'd recommend checking your radiator and replacing your radiator before you assume you have a bad head gasket. Anyways, guys, that covers it for all of the causes and diagnostic steps to figure out what's causing your engine overheating. There certainly are a couple things that we didn't include on this list that could potentially cause overheating. However, we wanted to focus on the most common thing, and the majority of the time, one of these 10 things that we mentioned here is going to be what's causing your overheating. Follow our checklist, diagnose every single one of these components, and somewhere along the way, you should be able to tell where the issue is. If you guys appreciated this video, please click the like button, subscribe to our channel, and stay tuned for future content.